It's who I am.
Yes, God, you're perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. A peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love. Love, love, you're good, good Father. That's who you are. That's who you are. That's who you are. And I'm loved by you. That's who I am. That's who I am. That's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. Believe that you are perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us.
Hear my cry, fill
thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. I've seen many searching for answers. Searching for answers, only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am. Yes, God, you're perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Love so undeniable. Call me deeper still as you call me deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. We believe that you are perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all.
Yeah. There's nothing our God can't do. Dear Heavenly Father, we lift you up this morning, Lord Jesus. Lord, thank you, God, for your power, your glory, your might. Lord, you are powerful. Lord, you parted the Red Seas. Lord, by your power, you used David to defeat Goliath. Lord, by your power, you delivered Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego from the fire. Lord, give us the faith to fully trust in you. As Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, even if our God doesn't deliver us, we still will not bow down. He still will be our God. Lord, we don't know why things happen and why you allow things to happen, Lord. But you are on the throne, and you are in control. And Jesus, when you walked this earth, you cared for the poor. You cared for the needy, the blind, the weak, the cripple, the prostitutes. and you didn't judge us. You didn't throw stones at us. Yet you loved us and you cared for us. And it's by that same love and kindness that leads us to repentance. It leads us to say, Lord, I don't want to live a life of brokenness anymore. I don't want to live a life that's empty. And you say, just go and don't sin. Go and don't hurt yourself anymore. Lord, you loved us so much that you died on the cross for us. You could have come down from the cross, but you chose to stay up there. And like Scripture says, before the earth was created, you had our names in mind. And you knew that this is what had to be done for you to be with us. And right now, just fill us with your Holy Spirit, Lord. Fill this room with your presence, God. Just overwhelm us with your love. Embrace us with your love. Just hug us with your love. The love that the world doesn't give. The love that success doesn't give. The love that money doesn't give. Fill us right now, Lord, with your Holy Spirit. And as we worship you, Lord, let us worship you because you are our Lord. You are our Savior. And you have rescued us from eternal punishment. And you've brought us into light. And you've called us your children. And our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life for those who believe in you, Jesus. And you want us to be thankful because we have eternal life. Thank you, Jesus. Let us worship you.
As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you feel the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will feel me come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you feel the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will feel me. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Fire. Fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you feel the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will feel me. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you feel the room,
You're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you are feeling me. There's maybe a prayer that you've been asking God to answer in a way that you would like to answer it. I just want you to just lift that up to God this morning. If there's somebody that maybe is on your heart, just pray for them. Just pray for them. God is at work. He's at work even when we don't see it, and he's moving and he's orchestrating things, and we want to trust in him. But let's just take a moment just to pray. We're going to sing Holy Spirit, Come Rest on Us one more time. But just take a minute just to pray. Maybe it's something in your heart, something that you've been praying for, someone, and just lift them up in the name of Jesus just right now. Lord, the word that comes to mind for me is healing. Lord, Lord, heal us, God. If there's someone that's sick, Lord, we ask, we lift them up in the name of Jesus, just to heal them. Lord, heal our land, heal our country. Let us not just go to blows because we don't like the same flavor ice cream or whatever. It seems like we're just so short with everybody. So full of hate, so full of fear. Lord, we ask that you heal our land and heal the hearts that have been hardened towards you, Jesus. We ask that you soften their hearts, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Holy Spirit, come. Rest on us. You're all we want. You're all we want. Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. You're all we want. Amen. You may have a seat. Thank you.
everybody. As you guys know, tomorrow is Veterans Day, and so we do want to acknowledge and thank our veterans for serving our country. And if we have any in the house, we'd want you to stand so we can thank you and pray for you this morning. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. If you guys will remain standing, we're going to pray for you. And it's men like this and women, of course, that have served our country and give us the freedoms that we have here in America. And we just exercised one of them last Tuesday, and that is the freedom to elect our officials. And so we thank God for America. Thank God for the men and women who have served our country and sacrificed so much. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for our country. Lord, we thank you for the freedoms that we have in this country. And Father, we know that it's been men and women who have served our country and protected this land, protected our freedoms, that made it all possible. And of course, Lord, you have guided, you have directed, your hand has been on this country, and we thank you for America. Thank you for the men and women who serve our country currently and those who have served our country in the past. We pray that you would bless them, Father, this weekend as we take time to thank them. And so, Lord, bless them, their families. We thank you for them, the sacrifices they've made to protect our freedoms and to protect our land. We love you, Lord. We thank you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen, amen. Amen. Well, welcome to our Sunday morning service. We do have a few announcements before we continue on. And I do want to remind you that this Tuesday we are having a men's Bible study. Every Tuesday night we gather in the fellowship hall at 7 o'clock. All the men are welcome. We are currently studying the book of Romans. Also, there is a prayer meeting on Tuesday morning. It is open to everybody. If you can't make it for some reason, there's a prayer tab on the side of your bulletin. If you would fill it out. It would be an honor to pray for you. That's Tuesday morning, 8:30. Of course, the women's Bible study is continuing every Thursday at 6:30. And next week, next Sunday, is the last Sunday to collect our Christmas boxes. So if you have taken home a Christmas box and haven't returned it yet for Samaritan's Purse, we want to encourage you to bring that next Sunday. Next Sunday is the last day, and you can see Heidi if you have any questions regarding that. Also, candlelight dinner is around the corner, believe it or not. December is next month. Wow, time flies. December 7th. It's not going to be the second Saturday. It's the first Saturday of December, and that is December 7th, 5 p.m. through 8 p.m. And my wife is asking if there's any ladies that wants to sponsor a table. We still need a few tables to be sponsored. So please see her after the service if you would like to do that. Also, there is a sign-up list in the back. So it's important that if you're planning on going, that you sign up so we can have an idea of how many people are coming. And so we can buy food accordingly. Yes, and Dean has a question. I'm sorry?
My wife's studying in our house.
Yes. Oh, okay. So no women's study this week. Okay. Thank you, brother. Appreciate it. Yeah. Thank you. And speaking of Dean Bierman in a few weeks is going to have the results of all the measures that we voted for. Of course, we know who won the election, and there's no question about that. Amen. Not only did he win the Electoral College vote, but the popular vote. I mean, it was a red wave all over the place. And I think the American people seen enough the last 4 years, and they spoke. And, you know, now this government has a clear mandate from the people, and we'll see what they do with that. And we need to continue to pray and continue to be involved. Again, our hope is not in a president. Our hope is not in the government. But we do want to see righteousness prevail. Amen? And so I think, the American people have spoken loud and clear. And what an amazing election that was. Again, Dean will have some results for us on all the measures in a couple weeks, and he'll be passing those out. I think that's it for announcements. Just one quick one. If you would like to help out in the children's ministry, we can use your help. If you'd like to serve the Lord by serving kids, see Amber after the service. And then there's a few people that we need to pray for this morning. I received a text from Phil. He's asking prayer for Letitia. And so she's been sick all week and not sure what's going on exactly, but if we can pray for Letitia, if we can pray for Paul Marquez's mom, pray also for Priscilla and Justin. Priscilla's not feeling well, and pray for her and the baby. Also for Marilyn Shepherd and Cindy Smith. Cindy Smith is here. If we can have Cindy Smith stand, we're going to pray for her. Our dear sister, she's going to be having surgery this Thursday, and her back went out this morning. So as she was setting up. So we need to pray for her. She's having surgery this Thursday. Maybe some of the ladies that are around there can just lay your hands on her and pray for her back. And then she's having oral surgery on Thursday. And so let's pray for her and for our other brothers and sisters that need our prayers. Heavenly Father, we do want to pray for our dear sister this morning. We pray for Cindy Smith, Lord. We pray that you would heal her and help her, Father. Father, as her back went out this morning, I pray that you would help her, Father, alleviate the pain that she's experiencing even now. Lord, we pray for your healing touch on her body. Father, we also pray for her surgery this Thursday as she has oral surgery. I pray, God, that you would go before her, that you would give her peace, that you would help her to know that you are in control. Father, I pray for the dentist, for the surgeons that would be performing this procedure, that you would give them skill, and that, Father, it would be a success. And Lord, we just pray for her today. We also want to pray for our sister Letitia, who's not feeling well. Pray for Letitia. We pray for Priscilla. We also pray for Marilyn, Lord. Paul Marquez's mom, Lord, you know their needs. Father, we just lift them up. And anybody else who is here, Lord, you know everyone here. You know, Father, the things that they're experiencing even this morning. I pray, Father, that you would meet your people right where they're at. Father, that you would heal, that you would help, that you would encourage, that their faith would be strengthened this morning. Father, as Pastor Larry speaks on faith, may you give us faith, strengthen our faith, Lord, to endure the things that we are experiencing today, Lord. We love you, God. We thank you. We ask that you would bless this service, and may you be in our midst. And we ask this in Jesus' precious name. And all God's people said, amen, amen. If the brothers would come forward, we'll receive this morning's offering. Just want to remind you, it is your generosity, your faithfulness that keeps the lights on in this place. And so thank you for giving, and want to encourage you to keep giving so that we can continue to meet here and pay the bills and go forward for the kingdom of God. Amen? Let's pray. God, thank you once again for your faithfulness to us, Lord. We thank you for every blessing that you have given us. We realize, Lord, it's all from you. And Lord, we just want to give back to you. We want to honor you, Lord, with our finances this morning. We acknowledge, Lord, that everything we have is from your hand, and we thank you for it, Lord. We love you, Lord. We pray that you would bless this offering, bless the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand, when everything around me shakes. is faithful through generations. So why would he fail now? He won. He won. And I still got joy.
Let's all stand up together, kids. You're dismissed. And let's go ahead and say good morning to somebody and God bless you. Amen. amazing grace, so sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. For I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. Hallelujah.
Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave.
The sinner now the same, for the God who died came back to life and everything was changed.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
Death, where is your sting? Oh, fear, where is your power?
The mighty King of Kings has disarmed you.
Delivered and redeemed, eternal life is ours.
Oh, praise his name.
Dear God, thank you for your goodness. Lord, I know you want me to be blessed and happy. And that's why, God, I pray you, please, let me have this Corvette I've been looking at. I really like it. And God, if it be your will, please, make it cherry red. Amen.
Lord, I'm single. And I'd really like to find that special someone. I kind of thought you'd have this problem figured out by now. Anyway, now is the time, Lord. Make it happen. Bring me a man.
Lord, I know it is your desire to make your children happy. And I've got a situation here. All of my neighbors have gotten in-ground pools. I'm the only one on the block that doesn't have one. God, you can do better than this.
As you know, Lord, I just released my first album, and it's not getting the kind of attention I hoped for. God, I know that you are capable of anything. You're all powerful. So please, Lord, make my album trend. Make it trend, Lord, make it trend. Ignite social media with your holy fire so that I may be glorified in all I do. Amen.
What's going on?
Why isn't this working?
Come on! I want this car! God, give it to me! Right now!
Hello? Hello?
I don't understand! Where's my pool?
Why is this not working?
What is wrong with this thing?
God, what are you doing? I want this!
What is going on?
I can't look bad in front of my friends!
Are you kidding me?
Come on, God!
What am I supposed to do?
Are you listening to me?
Give me a break here!
This stupid going on!
What is the matter?
God, I want my car!
God, are you even listening to me?
God, are you even listening to me?
Father, we come before you and we thank you for this day. We thank you for your grace and your mercy. We thank you for your love, your compassion. We thank you, Father, for your blessings over us in so many ways. Father, we thank you for your will in our lives. Father, we pray for our children this morning. We ask that you would have your way in our classrooms. The teachers, Father, all that they've studied. And we pray, Father, that our children would come to know Jesus, and Father, that they would be good witnesses of him in a world that needs to hear about him. And so we pray your blessings over our children's ministry this morning. We pray also, Lord, for this sanctuary. We pray, Father, for each one here as we look at this important lesson on faith. And we ask, Father, for you to help us to understand it, to take it into our hearts and to apply it to our lives. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to begin by thanking you for voting your biblical values this last week. Every vote matters. And Donald Trump won according to the votes. Amen. I said last week that I thought that he was the best candidate of the two who would bring biblical values to the table, who would be the one who would be the closest to what the Bible says we should be doing. And so I'm thrilled that he was voted to be our 47th president of the United States. Is he perfect? No. Will he do everything that we want? No. But I think that, as I said, he's the one that was the closest to biblical values. And so as we voted for him then, I was gratified that the nation embraced him. And so we look forward to his presidency and what he might be able to do to turn things around for our nation. Let's bow our heads and our hearts. Father, we pray for Donald Trump and for this presidency. We ask, Father, that you would just bless him and direct him and guide him according to your word. We pray, Father, that he would pick his Bible up and read it, And Father, that he would govern based on the principles that are found in the scriptures. We pray, Father, against the evil and the destruction that some people might be planning as a result of this election. We pray, Father, against abortion. Father, we pray against this evil that has plagued our society. We pray, Father, that people would be convicted of how wrong it is. And Father, we pray that this genocide in our nation, Father, could be stopped. We pray, Father, for freedom, for prosperity, and blessings upon our nation. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, even with the election of Donald Trump, we are still living in troubled times. We're still living in uncertain times. We're living in an unstable moment. For a lot of us, it all started in 2020 when Joe Biden was elected and he started his war on fossil fuels. And then that doubled the price of oil, and then that doubled the price of gasoline, and then that doubled the price of everything else. Because most of what we do in our society is based on oil, it's based on energy. And you can't attack that and drive prices up and then have no consequences. The radical reduction in oil, reduction in oil production resulted in a lot of what this inflation is all about. You don't have to be a genius to figure out that if you double the price of energy, you're going to double the price of everything else. Families have had trouble affording putting food on the tables. People have not been able to buy new cars. If you look at the price of new cars, people have had difficulty buying homes. If you look at the prices of homes. Added to all this is the fact that our country has been swimming in debt. The national debt of the United States as of last week was about $36 trillion. Now that's a huge sum of money, and let me help you put your arms around that. If you laid a trillion $1 bills end to end, it would stretch to the moon and back 200 times. If you could count one number per second, it would take you 32,000 years to count to a trillion. If you take, it would take you 1,110,000 years to count to 36 trillion. So that's how much debt we have on our country. Along with the economic instability is the threat of terrorism, the threat that we've already been infiltrated, the threat that a lot of people in our country will be attacked by terrorists. All this adds up to a frightful uncertainty for a lot of people. And this is why I believe that Donald Trump was elected this last week. People are tired of prices going out of control. They're tired of crazy, insane policies like letting men play women's sports. They're tired of funding endless wars. And as I've already told you, my vote was a vote to end the genocide against our children, about 1 million babies being aborted every year in this country. Abortion is the leading cause of death in the United States. More than heart disease, more than cancer, more than any other cause of death in the United States. Abortion is the leading cause of death. I think we all hope that a change in our leadership will do some things to alleviate all of this. But still, there are a lot of people who have fear about the future. Let me read to you about a survey that was done a few years ago. The majority of all Americans believe that the future is not going to be a good one. With tsunamis, earthquakes, and financial concerns dominating the headline news, National Geographic initiated a survey about what Americans think about the potential of a doomsday scenario. Here were some of the key findings. More than 62% of Americans think that the world will experience a major catastrophe in the next 20 years. That's two-thirds just about. Four of the most likely disaster scenarios include, in order of significance, earthquakes, hurricanes, terrorist attack, financial collapse. 71% of Americans envision a major disaster in their lifetime as an act of God and not man. 85% said they're not ready for such a devastating event. 25% claim they've done absolutely nothing to prepare for a major disaster. It's estimated that over 3 million Americans are actively preparing for the end of the world. In the face of all this uncertainty, then, I have a question to ask you this morning. How do you deal with it? How do you deal with the fear of disaster, the fear of not making it, the uncertainty that faces your life? One response would be to just give in to the fear. Let fear rule your life. Let fear rule everything you do. Become a doomsday prepper, so to speak, full time. How can we have peace in an uncertain world? How can we find tranquility in the face of such uncertainty? Well, the Bible tells us that it must come through faith, faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We cannot trust our governments. We cannot trust human beings. We must put our trust in God. That is how we can have peace in an uncertain world. This morning, as we continue on in the Gospel of Matthew, we're going to see two different things. First, we're going to be looking at unbelief and what it does, and then we're going to be looking at faith and what it does. Would you open your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter 21, verse 14? And let's now continue on in our study of the Gospel of Matthew. We read here, "Then the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying out in the temple saying, 'Hosanna to the Son of David,' they were indignant. And they said to him, 'Do you hear what these are saying?' And Jesus said to them, 'Yes, have you never read, out of the mouths of babes and nursing infants, you have perfected praise?' Then he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, and he lodged there." So here we have another example of the unbelief that Jesus encountered in the religious leadership of Israel. Here we're told it's the chief priests and the scribes that had no faith or belief in Jesus. But they had every reason to believe, you see. They had all the proof that they needed that Jesus was the Christ, the anointed one of God. Remember the context of these verses. Jesus had just entered Jerusalem as the long-awaited Messiah, fulfilling Zechariah 9:9 by riding in on the back of a donkey. Jesus had shown that he was the Messiah by arriving on the very day that Daniel had predicted that Messiah would present himself in Daniel 9:25. You remember in that verse, Daniel predicted that in 483 years from the command to restore and rebuild Jerusalem, that Messiah would present himself to Israel. Jesus presented himself on that very day, and no one else did. So it proved that Jesus is Messiah to the exclusion of all others. But still, the religious leaders refused to believe in Jesus. They were indignant. They were angry at him. Instead, they were planning how they could kill him. Therefore, we read here in Matthew chapter 21, verse 14, "Then the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying out in the temple saying, 'Hosanna to the Son of David,' They were indignant, and they said to him, "Do you hear what these are saying?" Here then is the context. Jesus had just fulfilled major prophecies proving that he was the Messiah of Israel. And here he was now in the temple fulfilling other major prophecies about the Messiah of Israel through his healing of the blind, through his healing of the lame. All of this had been predicted by the Old Testament prophets. But still, the religious leaders did not believe in him. And we see that for these men, their rejection of Jesus Christ had nothing to do with the evidence. They had all the evidence that they needed to believe in him. And so it is for most people. Their rejection of Jesus Christ is really not about the evidence. You see, they have the evidence of the eyewitnesses recorded in the Bible. They have the evidence of the amazing fulfilled prophecies that Jesus fulfilled in the Bible. They have the evidence of the conviction of God in their hearts. And yet still people reject Jesus. And the question then is why? Jesus said this about himself and those who reject him in John chapter 3. He said, "He who believes in him," speaking of himself, "is not condemned. But he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. But he who does the truth comes to the light, that his deeds may be clearly seen, that they have been done in God." So here is the bottom line. Why did these men not want to believe in Jesus? Well, Jesus says it's simple. Because they do not want to give up their wicked ways. And so it is with most people who reject Jesus in our own times. It's not about the evidence. It's not about the proof. It's that they don't want to give up their wicked ways. You need to understand then that unbelief is the great destroyer of people's souls. Because when you think about it, we know that God has made a way of escape from every sin but one. And what is that? Unbelief. Because if you do not believe in the Savior, you cannot be saved. Because he came to pay the price for your sins. He came to extinguish the price of every sin that besets you, to wipe it out. But if you will not believe in him, then you cannot be saved. What does 1 John 1:9 tell us? If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So if you reject Jesus and you exercise unbelief, then you're committing the only sin that cannot be forgiven because you've rejected the only way of salvation. Now, what was Jesus' response to the unbelief of the chief priests and the scribes? It was to affirm that what the Bible predicted about the Messiah was true. What the children were saying in the temple was true. By no means was he about to silence this beautiful praise that he deserved. We read here, in verse 14, "Then the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did and the children crying out in the temple, saying, 'Hosanna to the Son of David,' they were indignant and said to him, 'Do you hear what these are saying?' But Jesus said to them, 'Yes. Have you never read, out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have perfected praise? Then he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, and he lodged there. So it's the sad reality that Messiah was met not only with the praises of the people and the praises of these children, but he was also met with the anger and the rage of the Jewish religious leadership that rejected him. These circumstances then lead into another interesting miracle that speaks to us both about unbelief and about faith. So we continue on here in verse 18. Now in the morning, as he returned to the city, he was hungry. And seeing a fig tree by the road, he came to it and found nothing on it but leaves, and said to it, "Let no fruit grow on you ever again." Immediately the fig tree withered away. Now the miracle performed here is often called the cursing of the fig tree. And I think the best way to understand the meaning of this is to think about the visual aspect of it. Jesus is walking back into the city. He sees this fig tree and it looks impressive. It has a lot of leaves. It has a lot of growth. And from a distance, it looks fantastic. But when you get close to the fig tree, there's no fruit on it. There's nothing for you to eat. Now, Mark mentions in chapter 11, verse 13 of his gospel, the fact that it was not the season for figs, he says. Now, one might be tempted to think that Jesus was foolish in looking for fruit, but you need to understand how Palestinian fig trees work. In the spring, they bring forth sort of a small green bud that was a delicacy in Jesus' day. And then these buds fall off, and in their place comes up the figs. But in reality, then, Jesus was looking for these small buds that would be on the fig tree that was considered a delicacy at the time, and there was none. And so it indicated that this tree would produce no fruit. Now, the real focus of the fig tree is not on the figs. It's actually on Israel. The fig tree and the vine in the Old Testament are time-honored symbols of Israel. God, in the form of Jesus Christ, had come down, and he was expecting fruit from Israel. He was expecting Israel to embrace him. He is the long-predicted Messiah, the one that the prophets spoke about. And he was expecting Israel to recognize this fact through all of the many miracles that he performed, through all of his wonderful teaching, through the way that he lived. He revealed himself to be Messiah. But what he had found in coming down to Israel was nothing but leaves. There was no fruit. The religion of the leaders of Israel looked impressive on the outside, you see. They wore these long robes. They had all these ceremonies, and they said prayers out in public. They did all these things that looked so impressive, so pious. But there was no real fruit underneath the leaves. Instead, they rejected the Messiah. And Jesus' judgment of the fig tree is symbolic of the judgment that God will bring down upon Israel. In 70 AD, God's judgment would fall upon the nation. The Romans would invade and destroy. The leafy tree promised fruit but yielded none and would be judged as a result. God expected them to be fruitful but instead found a barren fig tree. And so it is with many people who put up a religious exterior and have no fruit. This is not to be true of us believers. There is no such thing as a fruitless Christian. God's true people will manifest the fruit of God in their lives. An unfruitful fig tree is good for nothing. And an unfruitful Christian is good for nothing as well. In Luke chapter 13, Jesus spoke a parable. We read here in verse 6. He also spoke this parable. A certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came seeking fruit on it and found none. Then he said to the keeper of his vineyard, "Look, for 3 years I've come seeking fruit on this fig tree and find none. Cut it down. Why does it use up the ground?" But he answered and said to him, "Sir, let it be done this year. Let it alone, pardon me. Sir, let it alone this year also, until I dig around it and fertilize it. And if it bears fruit, well. But if not, after that, you can cut it down." Can a baby be born and not grow? Can a Christian be born again and not grow? God expects his people to produce fruit. Now, we don't do good works, we don't produce good fruit in order to be saved. It is the result of being saved, you see. You're saved, and then you will produce good fruit because salvation is real. It's changed you, and you're trying to carry out the will of God in your life. It's one thing to know that a tree is unfruitful then. It's another thing to correct that unfruitfulness. If a tree is going to have a chance at solving the problem of unfruitfulness, then there needs to be a correction brought. And this is what Jesus did when he cleansed the temple. Remember, he came into Jerusalem revealing that he was the Messiah. And what's the first thing that he did? He went to the temple in order to cleanse the temple because it had become corrupt. We read there in Matthew chapter 21, verse 12, if you want to look back. Then Jesus went into the temple of God and drove out all those who bought and sold in the temple and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And then he said to them, "It is written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer,' but you have made it a den of thieves." So this was the problem with Israel. This was the problem with the fig tree. It looked impressive on the outside, but because of unbelief, there was no fruit. Because of unbelief, the nation was barren. So the curse was pronounced by Jesus on the tree. Now in the morning, as he returned to the city, he was hungry. And seeing a fig tree by the road, he came to it and found nothing on it but leaves, and said to it, "Let no fruit grow on you ever again." Immediately, the fig tree withered away. Israel, in her first century configuration, would be destroyed. She would be shattered. She had rejected the Messiah, had produced no fruit. And so Israel in that configuration would be done away with. Luke tells us when Jesus approached the city of Jerusalem, that he uttered this prophecy over it. He saw the city and wept over it, saying, "If you had known, even you, especially in this your day, the things that make for your peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. For days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment around you, surround you and close you in on every side and level you and your children within you to the ground. And they will not leave in you one stone upon another because you did not know the time of your visitation." This prophecy was literally fulfilled. In 70 AD, the Roman general Titus entered into the city of Jerusalem with the 5th, 10th, 12th, and 15th Roman legions, and he leveled the place. The Jews had been rebelling against the Romans, and after a great siege, Titus took the city. The historian Josephus tells us that a great number of Jews, somewhere around 1.5 million, were killed when Titus took the city. He leveled the city and crushed it. The Christians that were in the city were not killed or destroyed because they believed in what Jesus said, and when they saw the Roman armies coming, they vacated the city. So the curse that Jesus pronounced on the fig tree came true. Now, Jesus also uses the cursing of the fig tree then to teach his disciples about faith. Let's continue on here in Matthew chapter 21. Now in the morning, as he returned to the city, he was hungry. And seeing a fig tree by the road, he came to it and found nothing on it but leaves, and said to it, "Let no fruit grow on you ever again." Immediately the fig tree withered away. And when the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, "How did the fig tree wither away so soon?" So Jesus answered and said to them, "Assuredly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to the fig tree, but also if you say to this mountain, 'Be removed and be cast into the sea,' it will be done. And whatever things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive." The disciples were amazed at Jesus' power to bring this tree to nothing. But Jesus wanted them to know that they had the same power available to them that he had. And therefore, when they ask him this question, "How did the fig tree wither away so soon?" Jesus responds, "Assuredly, I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to the fig tree, but also if you say to this mountain, 'Be moved and be cast into the sea,' it will be done. And whatever things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive." So, according to Jesus, the key to wielding the same power that he has is faith. Faith. It all comes down to faith. "Assuredly, I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt," Jesus says. The Greek word translated faith here is pistis. Pistis means a belief directed toward a person, a thing, having trust in, confidence in, reliance on. Christian faith is always directed toward God. There is an object to our faith, and that is God. We put our belief and our trust in him, and then he performs through his power whatever his will is in our lives. Now, this is a far cry from what is taught by the Word of Faith and the prosperity preachers. They preach that faith is a force. Faith is a power. It's an energy field. And they say that if we learn to manipulate faith, then we can create anything that we want to. And they also claim that God is the ultimate manipulator of faith. God isn't the object of faith in their view. No, he's just a guy like you and me who learned how to use the force of faith. And that's what they teach to people. And so this is where the name it and the claim it comes from. This is where the blab it and the grab it comes from. Visualization techniques. You know, if you visualize an 82-foot yacht inside your garage, then it will come to pass if you have the force of faith and know how to use it. If you visualize money in your bank account, it will come to pass if you know how to manipulate the force of faith. To which we could ask, well, then why are you asking for donations? Why don't you just make that money appear in your own account and leave the rest of us alone? So this is how the faith and prosperity preachers twist the scriptures. They teach that it's all about the power of faith. But what does the Bible tell us? Well, the Bible tells us that our faith is not in faith. Our faith is in who? Is in God, right? It's in Jesus. It's in the power of God to deliver whatever he wants. And so then the prosperity preachers are wrong, and true biblical scholarship triumphs over them. God is not some guy with incredible control over faith. No, God is the object of our faith. God doesn't have faith at all. He doesn't need faith. God does whatever he wants, whenever he wants, however he wants. So we are not trying to manipulate the force of faith. We're appealing to an all-powerful God who has the right to say yes, no, or wait. And that's the one I always hate. Wait. I can accept yes. Oh, yeah, absolutely. No, well, maybe I'm not happy about that one. But wait. Oh, man. You mean I'm going to have to pray about this for years? Yeah. And that's how God often tries our faith. So God doesn't have trust that things will happen. He doesn't hope that things will happen. God makes things happen. He's all powerful. In Mark chapter 11, verse 22, the parallel account to this one, Jesus says, have faith in God. So our faith is not in faith. Our faith is in God. And that's why I played that video, the cosmic vending machine, for you. That's what we're getting to this morning. Are you expecting God to do everything for you, to just hand you all of this stuff, whatever you want? That's not biblical faith. There's that guy, though, the prosperity preacher who refuses to go away. And he says to me, but Pastor, doesn't it say this in the Bible? And whatever things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive. Doesn't it say? Assuredly, I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to the fig tree, but also if you say to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, it will be done. Doesn't it say all of these things? Doesn't that mean that whatever I ask, then God has to give to me? No, not at all. Because our faith is in God, then that places a righteous limit on what we can ask for. We can only ask for those things that are within God's will, do you see? We can only ask for those things that are consistent with God's character. You can't get mad at somebody and say, dear Lord, help me murder this person. God isn't going to answer that prayer. It's not consistent with who he is, with his character. You can't say something like, well, you know, I need a whole lot of money, Lord, so help me rob this bank today. God isn't going to answer that prayer because it's inconsistent with his character. Prayers that are inconsistent with the character of God will not be answered. Our faith is in God, and therefore there is a righteous limit on what we can ask. It has to be consistent with his will, and it has to be consistent with what? His character. James rebuked the church with these words in James chapter 4, verse 2 and following. You lust and do not have, you murder and covet and cannot obtain, you fight and war, yet you do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask amiss, that you might spend it on your pleasures. Adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. What did the Apostle John say about prayer in 1 John chapter 5? Now, this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to what? Anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we have asked of him. So this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, that he hears us. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, it will be opened. Or what man is there among you who, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? Underscore good things. Things that are consistent with his character, consistent with his will. God always answers our prayers. Yes, no, and wait. Okay. Now, let's talk for a moment about the imagery here in verses 21 and 22. Jesus said, assuredly, I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to the fig tree, but also if you say to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, it will be done. And whatever things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive. Now, I don't know of anyone who has ever literally carried this out in their lives. I don't know of anyone in history that it's ever been recorded that they prayed to God to move a mountain and it was moved for them. Now, why hasn't that happened? Because those prayers were not according to God's will, not consistent with his character at the time. But if God wanted you to move a mountain and you prayed over it, Jesus is saying he'll do it if it's consistent with his will and his character. So there's that aspect of what we're looking at here. But also we need to understand that the mountain is really a metaphor. It's a metaphor for all the difficult things that you face in life. What does he say? But also if you say to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, it will be done. And whatever things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive. What is Jesus really saying here? Well, God will do great and tremendous things in your life if it is his will. So if you pray for the mountains in your life to be removed, and God has that in his will, then he will do it. Let me give you an example. My son was a drug addict for about 25 years. And for a long time, I was waiting for the phone call. Mr. Blanchard, your son is dead. I was just waiting for the phone to ring. I just knew he was going to die. I tried to do everything I could to stop it. I tried to get in his way. I tried to do everything I could. And then he was homeless for 2.5 years, and I thought, this is it. It's going to happen. One night, he got down on his hands and knees, and he gave his life to Jesus. And that changed him totally and completely. I prayed for this mountain to be moved in my life for 25 years, brothers and sisters. And I got to say, you know, I was like that man, you know, Jesus, I believe, help my unbelief. That was really my approach to prayer for my son. I prayed for him, and I was willing for whatever God, whatever his answer was. But I did not expect this mountain to be moved. But there at the very end, when it was just down to the very end, and the Lord moved it. One night, we had him over to our house to have some food, and then we couldn't let him stay there, and so I said, well, I'll take you and drop you off wherever you need to go. And so I did. I dropped him over in San Dimas here, and as I drove away, I felt the Lord say to me, if you don't get him now, he will die. I mean, it was really clear. It was impressed in my mind, you know. I knew it was the Lord talking to me. And so I turned around, I looked for him, and I couldn't find him, and then I found him, and he got in the car. And I said, let's not talk about it tonight, but let's go home. You need to take a shower. I want you to sleep at our house. And he said, okay. And the next day I told him, this is your last chance as far as what we can give. If you want to stay here and get cleaned up and get on the right track, you're welcome to do that. But you know all the rules. And he looked at me and he said, Dad, I'm ready. And that was the beginning of the change. But it all happened with the Lord, you know. The Lord told me he was going to die. The Lord told me to go back and get him. And now you guys know him. Isn't he a wonderful man in Christ? So that was a huge mountain in my life, and God moved it. I was willing for whatever the answer was, but I prayed that the mountain would be moved. Now, all of you have mountains in your life that you need to be moved. And you need to be willing for whatever the answer is, but it's not wrong for you to pray for that mountain to go away, for that mountain to be cast into the sea. This is what Jesus is saying. By faith, you can move mountains. By faith, the very power of God will be unleashed in your life. Assuredly, I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to the fig tree, but also if you say to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, it will be done. And whatever things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive. There is a warning in this, because we can look at our problems through strictly human point of view, a human perspective, and say, it's impossible, it'll never happen. Jesus is saying, don't give up, keep praying. The mountain can be moved if it's God's will, if it's within his character, he can do it. So this morning then, we've seen the impact of unbelief and the impact of faith. Unbelief brings destruction. Faith brings blessing. Todd was a 3-year-old boy from Rhode Island and went down the seacoast to fly a kite with his father. Never having flown the kite before, Todd had obvious doubts. His father assured him that all was well. The kite would go up as planned. As Todd unraveled the string and watched the kite go up, he was heard to be saying, I knew it would fly, Daddy. You said it would fly. A simple statement with profound implications. I knew it would fly, Daddy. You said it would fly. This is really what biblical faith is all about. Our Father in heaven tells us the truth, and we believe him. It's that simple. It's that profound. We believe he performs. That's how it works. Jesus is saying, in your life, the very power of God is available to you through faith. So let us seek his will. Let us pray continually. And let us move mountains together, brothers and sisters. Let's bow our heads and our hearts. Father, we come before you this morning, and we thank you for these words of our Savior that encourage us to not give up, to put our total trust and belief in God, to have faith that his power will be unleashed according to his will. I pray for each one in here. I pray over all the mountains that are represented in this sanctuary today. I pray, Father, that you will come to the aid of all of your people, that as they pray, that as they trust, that you will answer, and they will know that it was you. They will know that there was no other one who could do this. As you're having this time of prayer with the Lord, I want to offer Jesus to you right now. Jesus is the Savior, the object of our faith. We believe in a triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. If you're going to move mountains in your life, your faith has to first be in Jesus. And you can do that easily by just surrendering to him and then confirming that through this prayer. Father God in heaven, I come before you this morning. I repent of the times, Father, that I have wounded your heart, that I have violated your word and your commands. I receive Jesus as my Lord and my Savior. I make him my King. I put my total faith in him. Thank you, Father, for saving me. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, as I said a minute ago, let us move a lot of mountains. Amen.
Amen. We're going to do something a little bit different. We're going to sing There's Nothing That Our God Can't Do one more time. So let's all stand together. Team, I didn't let you know about this, so.
Whoa. Sorry.
No, you're good. I feel like we just got to, you know, let's do this one again because there is nothing our God can't do, and it's a good reminder for us. Amen? Here we go.
Darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that a God can't do. There's not a mountain that he can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Just one word, you heal what's broken inside me. Just one word, revive every dream. Just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that a God can't do. There's not a
bless you. We'll see you next week.
sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love.